I'm going to give you a short update on the dismal science, as economics is known, briefly refer to some of the studies that have been done on various economic and policy issues, but focus a bit more on some of the work we did, because they're quite, the issues that I want to highlight go much beyond the headline numbers, and they relate more to methods and choices, which are quite relevant as you start talking about metrics. Both in terms of the costs of air pollution and the benefits of policy measures to address them. So very briefly on some of the studies which have come out in the last couple of years, I must say, looking at various economic aspects, but also looking at the effectiveness of various policy measures. There was a study we did on the costs of the health impacts of air pollution from road transport. And that was primarily looking at the valuation of premature deaths and looking at OECD countries and some of the key emerging economies. This is the most recent assessment we did. It came out mid-2016, which I'll be talking about in detail in this presentation, so I won't say much right now. Then there was a companion piece done by our sister agency, the International Energy Agency, which was looking at the role of the energy sector, both with regard to outdoor air pollution, but also indoor air pollution. And then they looked at policy measures in the energy sector, in particular a clean air scenario of the IEA, and tried to quantify what the benefits would be in terms of reduced deaths and so on of that scenario. So that was the work that the IEA did. Then there was a study which came out a few months after our study, which is an economic assessment. It's a global assessment by the World Bank and IHME, and that's looking at the present situation and focused on the valuation of mortality impacts. And finally, there's a study by the UNECE, which is more of an assessment of the trends and the effectiveness of policies in the UNECE region. So that's the those are the studies that are cited in the science policy update. And I'd like to spend the next few minutes talking a bit more about the work we did, because it, in a way, captures more issues than some of the more focused studies. We looked at it's a global assessment. We're not only looking at the costs, the consequences of air pollution, outdoor air pollution today, but projecting those consequences up to 2060. And we're not only looking at evaluation of mortality, but we're looking at impact on morbidity and also market costs, both direct and indirect. So in terms of objectives and scope of the work, it was to look at how changes in outdoor air quality would affect the economy and consequences for long-term growth, and so the costs of inaction. And our approach was to take a regional and sectoral quantitative approach where possible, and we're looking at both market impacts and non-market impacts. And as I said, it's a global assessment with the 2060 time horizon. So what are the kinds of costs that we've looked at in this assessment? We've looked at health expenditures. We've looked at impacts on labor productivity as a result of illness, lost days at work, and how these transmit across the economy. We've looked at changes in crop yields. And so these are the market costs, and they have both dimensions. They have the direct dimension where you have the impacted sector or activity, but also the ripple effects through the economy. For example, if you're looking at changes in crop yields, beyond the changes in productivity of a particular crop, you would, through market channels, have substitution effects and then a transmission of those consequences through trade, for example. So we're looking at all those, what the economists call general equilibrium effects as well, not just the direct costs. But there are a lot of costs, obviously, which don't operate through market channels. So pain and suffering from illness, for example. Economists have this euphemism. They call it the disutility of illness. But if you're having an acute attack of bronchitis, the euphemism doesn't quite capture it. And of course, mortality. And so these are the non-market costs, which we have also looked at in our assessment. In terms of the market costs, we've looked at health expenditures resulting from cases of bronchitis in children and adults, hospital admissions for respiratory and cardiovascular diseases, changes in labor productivity, agriculture reduced crop yields, and we're using our computable general equilibrium model for this kind of analysis. On the non-market costs, we're using contingent valuation techniques to look at non-market health impacts. And here we're using the methodology that the OECD has approved some time back of calculating country-specific values for statistical lives based on income levels. And in terms of the non-market costs from morbidity, we look at several endpoints, including bronchitis cases in adults and children, respiratory and cardiovascular diseases, asthma, and so on. And the disutility or welfare costs are evaluated based on the willingness to pay results from a stated preference survey, which was done for the European Commission by one of the experts in the field, Mike Holland. Now, coming very quickly to the results, because I have a 10-minute quota. First, we sort of followed the economic activity to emissions, to concentrations, to impacts, to economic assessment. These are just the results from some of the front end. And here, we coupled our economic projections with emissions coefficients for the pollutants from EASA's gains model. And these are the projections we have normalized to 2010, which is at 1, all the way up to 2060. The pollutants, most of the emissions go up. In particular, there's a doubling of NOx emissions between now and 2060. Ammonia also increases quite rapidly. I think organic carbon comes down somewhat, partly due to fuel switching and by households and so on. And for SO2, it's quite interesting. You first have a decline in emissions for the next couple of decades, partly due to the effects of current policies, but then it is overtaken by the increases in demand, and then there's an increase in the SO2 emissions. From emissions, we go to concentrations using the TM5 FAST model of the Joint Research Center. And here, I mean, we've done this for ozone also, but I'm just showing you the annual average total anthropogenic PM2.5 concentrations. This is the picture in 2010, 2030. And that's the picture in 2060, and you can see the bullseye were India and parts of China. Now, because of the numbers on India and China, you're not able to see in this figure the increases that are also taking place elsewhere, but that's the big picture. I'm not going to talk about ozone here and come more to the next steps now, which is looking at the market costs. And here we're looking at what are the costs of outdoor air pollution on as a percentage of GDP. So health expenditures increase much more rapidly than GDP. Labor productivity impacts more or less track the health expenditures in terms of percentage of GDP. Agriculture more or less tracks GDP, so you don't see that much of a dramatic increase. And here, the indirect consequences are quite important, particularly the role played by trade and relative prices. And that's the total picture in terms of the evolution of market costs. They go from roughly 0.3% of GDP today to roughly 1% of GDP in 2060. But as I said, the market costs are just a very small piece of the puzzle, and then we look at both the costs of mortality and morbidity. Now, these are just the numbers on premature deaths from 2010 from GBD, and then, according to our modeling, we have projections of deaths going up to 2060. So the we have a range which is 6 to 9 million, and the uncertainty that you see is a result of only one factor here. There are plenty of reasons for uncertainty, but here we just looked at the uncertainty with regard to the concentration response function from PM2.5. What would be the added mortality at higher levels, higher concentrations of PM2.5? And the largest impacts you can see are in China and India, but also in some other countries of the world. Now, this information on premature mortality is combined with information on valuation to get the welfare costs of mortality. This is the picture in 2015, and then you have the increases for different regions. Now, the regions are somewhat opaque. I had to limit the number of regions here. Rest of Europe and Asia includes China, and that's the reason why you have the big bump. And South and Southeast Asia includes India, and that's the other peak. Now, coming very quickly to mortality. If you look at the welfare costs of mortality, the picture is quite different from morbidity. It's not just India and China, actually. China tops, it has the highest, but it's followed very closely by Korea. And then you have the Caspian region and Eastern Europe, and followed by India. So the picture on mortality and morbidity is not exactly the same. If we look at the total welfare costs of air pollution, so here we are first bringing the market costs to a welfare metric and then putting them alongside the welfare costs for the non-market costs. So these are the direct market costs, this is the welfare equivalent to the market costs. These are the indirect market costs, and here the point I'd like to highlight is this. Even when you're just looking at market costs, this underscores the importance of looking at the economy-wide effects, not just the impacted sector or activity. But then, if you start looking at non-market costs, then the axis has changed, and the market costs are a small sliver down there, and this is the lower estimate of the non-market costs, and then you have a higher estimate based on different assumptions with regard to the concentration response function of the non-market costs. So that's the total picture if you're looking at the welfare costs of outdoor air pollution. You have the market costs, which are important, and then you have non-market costs, which are roughly higher by a factor of 10. So some of the main insights from our study, the total welfare costs of outdoor air pollution will increase significantly in OECD countries, but will explode globally in the absence of more stringent policies. Indirect market consequences induced by market impacts play an increasingly important role, which should not be ignored. But overall, the largest component of welfare costs is the value of premature deaths, 80 to 90% of the costs. And these losses are the highest in China and India. Thanks a lot.